fired up on that one, didn't he?
Yes. Yes.
Sunday school on her.
Thank you, Father. Glory to the Lamb.
Thank you, God.
All right. Well, good morning. We'll open in prayer and then we'll get to the meat and potatoes of this. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for this congregation. We thank you for this church, Lord. We thank you for our pastor, his family. We just thank you for providing a God-fearing, God-loving presence in our life, Lord. We thank you for that. We ask you to be with me today as I bring your word. See, I got that right this time. And be with the congregation to open their ears, our eyes, hearts, and minds to receive the word that you want them to receive, Lord. Not the word that I'm sending to them, but the word that you want. So give us strength to do what you need us to do, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you younger folks, I know you won't know it, but there was a thing on Saturday mornings, okay? And I know Pastor Cooper never was involved in it because he didn't get to stay inside the house on Saturdays. He had to get out, right? Uh-huh. Money made you hit the ground, right? No. Well, if we didn't have football games or baseball or something, you know, you stay home and you might watch a couple hours of cartoons on Saturday. Uh-huh. Well, in between the cartoons, they had a little thing called Schoolhouse Rock, Education Rock, all kinds of rock. Yeah. And believe it or not, it was a cool way to learn things. That's what I thought anyways. And one of them was numbers. They would do multiplication of numbers. Who remembers the multiplication of three, right? 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, 30. Y'all remember that little jingle? No. Well, I mean, it put a way to learn your multiplications as well as just sitting there in front of the, as my mom used to call it, the boob troop, right? Because if you look in front of it too much, you become a boob. And a boob is a northern expression for a dummy, okay? Not anything the other way, okay? Today's Bible verses, we're going to be in verses Timothy, is there 2 Timothy 4, 7? Matthew 6, 33 through 34, Job 13, 15, Job 2, 9, and last but not least, 2 Timothy 4, 3. Now, those are in chronicle order, so that's the order that they will be in throughout the... So why didn't I start off with some goofy tale about threes, right? Education Rock, and specifically went to the three zone. Mm-hmm. Think about the world today as we're living it, okay? There's basically three things, right, that are affecting all our lives outside of God. Think about it. You have Corona, right? Or COVID, whatever you want to call it. You have the ungodly political elections, right? I mean, and then last, we have a civil unrest that is happening within not only America, but the world. You know, the United States affects a lot, you know. Mm-hmm. It doesn't just stay here in Callahan. It goes to the ends of the world. So, three things, right? That's where my little tie-in came into the 369 thing, all right? But thinking about this, how should we as Christians deal with this? I mean, how many conversations have you had about presidential elections or what one party said against another party lately? I mean, the other day there was a rally on the corner up here of 200 and 301. There's guys, people out there with signs, saying vote for me, vote for them, vote for who, vote for us, type of thing. And then coronavirus, you can't escape that, right? I mean, everywhere you turn, somebody's talking about, or somebody's getting ill. The news has it run rampant. And then the civil unrest. I mean, that runs rapid on the news day in and day out. Okay? And as it just continues to go and go and go and go. And what does this do to Christians?
It can become disturbing.
It's an easy factor. It's human nature, okay, to blame somebody else. Tell you that right now, okay? You start out with Adam, right? She made me do it. Right? How about Cain and Abel? You made me do it. Right? It's human nature.
My God.
And to find ways around things, I mean, now's an easy time in a whole life. If you're going to blame other people, you got three things right there that you can just fall back on anytime, right? Oh, I'm not doing well. Why? Because the president and the politicians and all that are not doing enough to take care of it, right? Or I can't go outside, I can't get a job because they got coronavirus. All right, that's a lie, just to let you know, okay? Right. There's people hiring out there left and right. It may not be the job that you want, okay?
Right,
but it's a job that can get you through, okay? It might be even add some more to your resume. Number three, civil unrest, okay? I ain't going outside. There's crazy people out there. There's people attacking people just for the heck of it. I talked to my sister Carol, who lives out in, we're basically Portland, okay? It's just right across the river, or the Columbia River, on the Washington side. She says that Portland is closed down every night. The city of Portland is closed down every night after 7 o'clock. So if you're a business person, they have a bigger downtown than we do, okay? A lot more buildings than we do, okay? If it's 7 o'clock and you're not gonna, you're an office guy or whatever, or an accountant or whatever, you better get your butt out of there. Because people are gonna take your stuff, they're gonna turn your car over. That's the big thing now. Turn cars over. But it takes away your freedom. It also gives you an excuse not to do something. Right? I'm not going to go down, to downtown Jacksonville, or I'm not going to go to one of the malls, to get a pair of pants I need or something, because you don't know if somebody's going to jack you up for it. Right? Right or wrong. Left or right. Front or back, there's a lot of excuses out there. And where I'm going with this, okay, since March of this year, okay, one in every three practicing Christians have left the church.
Wow.
One in three. And that's in... That's an article I read in a Christian website, Barna, BARNA.com. And it deals with, actually, it might be a good read for you to look in there. It deals with the ins and outs of churches. Put it that way. But one in three. That's a lot. Now, you ready for the kicker? Okay. That also includes virtual.
Wow.
That includes Zoom. That includes Facebook. There's a lot of different platforms
right.
where churches have turned to get the word out.
Yeah.
Right? That's it all. I can understand physical attendance churches. Okay? You know, people have medical issues that, you know, that they're susceptible, you know, or more susceptible to catching than, other things. Okay? And I understand that. But to turn on a Zoom or, and it's not that hard because this old guy can do it. You know what I mean? If not, have a couple of kids, wait 15 years, and then they'll tell you how to do it.
No, we
give
that.
Right? Well, think about it. I mean, my dad used me to lift things. That's what he always told me. We had you to lift things. You know, my middle brother, he was a smart one. We had you to figure out what was smart. My oldest brother, we won't tell you what they had. But we all have we all know somebody, okay? Or know of somebody, or even we all know a church, okay?
Right.
That if you are having trouble connecting to Zoom or Facebook, even, I mean, not even if this is church, if it's another church, we'll show you how to do it. Just make contact with us, okay? And we'll send my son to you. We might have him in a hazmat suit, but, you know, we'll send them to you and or on the phone and show you how to do it. I mean, there's no reason for us not to get our, and this is going to sound a little weird, but to get our weekly fix, okay? Or bi-weekly fix, or whatever you want to, I mean, get it. So in 2 Timothy 4:7, and I'm sorry for going out in the weeds, but I have a habit of doing that. You should see me play golf. Woo. I hit the woods really good. I'm telling you. Too bad they're trees, right? That's a golf joke. Uh-huh. So 2 Timothy 4:7. Okay, this is Paul. And Paul tells us, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Three, right? Three is kind of my thing right now. I was actually going to have him play something, but we decided not to. So Paul tells us three things to remember when the issues of the world presses our anxiety button. I mean, I don't know about you, but there has times that this has overwhelmed me. I mean, with the COVID, I mean, when it first started, I have a spreadsheet. Okay, this is how goofy I am. I have a spreadsheet that every afternoon I update that spreadsheet on county by county in Northeast Florida on how many cases per day, right? I also have it sectioned off the percentage of the increase, the number of the increase, the percentage that is compared to Duval County. I mean, it's I mean, it can really tie me up, if you want to put it that way. Okay, because of my concern. Think about it. We have a plague, for lack of a better word. Okay, we basically are living in a plague right now. We're in the dark ages. In the dark ages. Would you ever see that coming? It's just, anyways. So I have an anxiety button. I don't know about y'all, but I have an anxiety button. When that button's pushed, my wife goes into the other room. Okay? All right? My dogs run away. Those horses won't ever run away, but they'll stay there. My son, he just puts on his headsets and just nods his head at me. So, but it can change your life, okay? I mean, it can actually take over your life. So Paul tells us that this is near the ending of his ministries, okay? Now, we're talking about a man who was stoned to death, okay, or so they thought, for performing miracles. For helping people, he was stoned to death. If y'all know the story, they drug them off, okay, outside of the city. And then they went to start actually going to bury him, and he popped up. Boop. Hi there. I'm Paul. Crazy, ain't it? Mm-hmm. And now we're talking about, I mean, if anybody should have anxiety, it should be Paul. Mm-hmm. Not Jack. But he tells us that he fought the good fight.
Yeah.
Right? He finished the course.
Yeah.
And he kept the faith.
Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. Let's go by one, two, and three, okay? Fight the good fight. Obey. All right, we must let Jesus be the Lord of our hearts.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, our homes.
Yes.
Our habits.
Yes.
We cannot let, okay, as I have in the past, okay, and then probably going to be some in the future, and I have to repent for that and ask for forgiveness. But we cannot let those three things come between us and God. Okay,
that's right, that's
we cannot
right.
worry so much about getting corona that we stop going to church.
That's right.
Okay, we have to focus our life and our homes and our habits, and that's important, our habits, on God itself, on
yeah.
God himself, excuse me, to be the center focal point of our lives.
Yeah.
In Matthew 6, 33, 34, Jesus tells us, or you, or me, or all of us. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will worry about its own. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. That's deep.
Yeah.
And have you ever noticed when you read in these that there's always songs?
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Somebody between the writing of the gospel and today has taken so many of these verses and actually put them into songs. Talking about rock and roll songs, soul songs, funk.
Yeah.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
it just, anyways. I'm in the weeds again. I'm sorry. The verses here, their meaning are as direct as they sound. Okay? Paul's not fluffing this up any. All right? He's coming straight to you what needs to be happening. We are to seek the things of God as a priority over the things of the world. Got that? God first,
yes.
World fourth.
Yes.
About that, right?
Yes.
Primarily, it means that we are to seek the salvation that is inherent in the kingdom of God because of its greater value than the world's riches.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now I know I threw a bunch of junk in there, okay? But what it's saying is that being saved, having salvation, going to heaven is a lot more important than hitting $100 lottery ticket. Okay? Or $1 million lottery ticket, I'll tell you that right now. That's more important. I know some of y'all thinking, yeah, okay. But it is more important. Does this mean that we should neglect the reasonable and daily duties that help us sustain our lives? No. We need to go on and continue living our lives. Okay? We can't just sit on a rock and praise love to God. Okay? We are in the world. We have to allow God to help us provide for ourselves, our families, our friends. But the Christian, there should be a difference in the attitude towards them. If we are taking care of God's business as a priority, seeking his salvation, living in obedience to him, and sharing the good news of the kingdom to others, then he will what? He will take care of us.
Yes, he will.
If we are obedient to God, God would be obedient to us.
Right.
It's that simple. He promises that.
Mm-hmm.
And God does not break his promises.
Amen. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, finish the course. Keep your faith in God through the storms, the sorrows, and the situations in life. We must keep an attitude of faith and be like Job, who said in Job 13:15, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. So check this out, all right?
Yeah.
You're out in a parking lot at the airport. Worship him? The answer is no. You're going to be scared, right? But Job is sitting there saying that I am going to worship him. Now, there's a whole lot of difference between God and the guy sticking a gun at you at the airport.
That's right.
All right? But Job's talking about he's taking his life, that he knows that God is going to take his life. But he still worships him.
Yeah.
He still trusts in him.
Yeah.
I got a little secret that I might share with y'all. God's going to take all of our lives. Okay? Whether it's good or bad, God is going to take our lives.
Yeah. By God.
So, be prepared. As Deacon LV likes to say. Right? Don't get caught short. Because there's going to be a time in the day. And you know what? Like the end of the world, it isn't made privy to you. So Job made this statement, okay, when he was in a terrible time of his life. He had terrible pain. He was suffering. He had lost his children. He had lost his wealth. He had lost his health. Right? And check and check this. His friends were of no help to him.
Uh-huh. Right.
His wife offered no support and was in fact telling him to give up. In Job 2:9, his lovely wife tells him, then she said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity?
Uh-huh.
Curse God and die. And my wife told me to die a lot of times, okay, but this wasn't really meant this way, you know what I mean? I'm just teasing. She's a doll. That's more of an over thing, too. Anyways, so Job felt as though his life was over. The only thing left was to die. But as Job said, even if God did slay him, Job would still trust in him. The faith of Job is seen in the fact that even if God's plan results in Job's death, Job will continue to trust in God.
Yes.
Think about that. Sometimes people get mad at God for making a light. My very minute things. But we need to make sure that we trust in God.
Yes.
As Brother Cooper likes to say, is that there's it rains on the just and in the unjust.
Yes, right.
Okay.
Right.
There's a reason why God is putting you in the trial and tribulations that you're going through. Doesn't mean you know it. Doesn't mean he's gonna tell you. Job will continue to trust in God, as we have read, Nothing can shake the faith of someone who is so grounded in the goodness and the glory of God. Job may not understand what is happening to him or why, but God knows, but he knows that God is good, loving, and trustworthy. That's pretty tight. Think about it. You lose everything, okay? Figure about nowadays, you're homeless, right? You're standing on the corner hoping for change. And you still trust in God. That takes a lot of strength. So remember to finish the course with an attitude of faith in God. Number three, keep the faith. And as I said earlier, that we are living in a day when church attendance has dropped 33% since March of this year. The Apostle Paul tells us to be aware of these things. Way back then, he tells us to be aware of these things. In 2 Timothy 4:3, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itchy ears. Itchy ears.
Right.
That's an old expression.
Yeah.
So even back then, Paul warns the church that a time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine.
Right.
That makes sense? They won't believe what the preacher is saying up here.
Yeah.
Okay? Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. Well, I don't like what Pastor Cooper said this week. I'm not going back there. I'll go over to the Billy Bob's church and he'll tell us what we want to hear. We don't go to church to hear what we want to hear. Okay? What we should be going to church for, and I'm sorry if this is wrong, but what you're doing wrong, okay? It's easy to do things you know is right. It's hard to stop doing things that you know that are wrong. Especially ones that will make you money, give you pleasure, right? We need to go on anymore with these? No?
Yeah, go on.
So, I mean, itchy ears. What do you think itchy ears mean? What you want to hear?
Not the truth.
It's a figure of speech that refers to people's desires, felt needs. Okay, not needs, but felt needs. That means I want it. Don't need it, but I want it. Or wants. It is these desires that impels a person to believe whatever he wants to believe rather than the actual truth itself. And y'all know I've warned y'all about, you know, looking at a, you know, when we're talking like in Sunday school and when you're doing research on what I have said up here, when you're checking me, okay, is make sure that it comes from a sound website. There are people out there putting anything and everything on the internet as lies, okay, because it's about getting what these things called hits, okay, all right. In my generation, getting hits isn't a good thing unless you were a baseball player. Okay? Don't want nobody hitting on me. But think about it. They won't come to church because Pastor Cooper said something that touched the nerve. Okay? Or I said something that touched the nerve that you didn't agree with.
Right.
Not that because you didn't know it wasn't sound doctrine,
right,
okay, but because you didn't like it.
Right.
So no more eating ice cream. Say that right now. God said no more eating ice cream. And I won't see y'all next week. I know that. Right? Y'all eat ice cream, you can't come here no more. Ain't that crazy? I could put that on the internet.
Yeah.
And I'm sure, you know, if somebody's Zooming this right now and they don't like me, they could put it on the internet and say the nutbag in Callahan. Right. And that's, and believe it or not, that's the biggest thing where they take verbiage out of context. Okay? And they have been doing it a while with preachers.
Yes.
Okay. When people have itchy ears, they decide for themselves what is right or what is wrong. And they seek others. Now, this is the important part. They seek others to support their notions. Okay?
Yes, that's right.
They're not going to come to you and sit there and ask you a question. Pastor, you know, I'm going through this right now. What do you think the Lord and I should do? Okay? And hear what he has to say. And if he don't agree with it, they're going to go find the next pastor. Okay? If they don't agree with that, they go to the next pastor. And then you know what they do after that? They phone it in. Then you know whose fault it is? It's God's. Itching ears are concerned more about what feels good and or what is comfortable, not with the truth. Paul's warning is that the church would one day contain those people who only open their ears to those who would scratch their itch. Those with itchy ears only want to hear teachers who will assure them that all is well. Teachers that will say peace, peace, peace when there is no peace.
My God.
So remember to keep the faith.
Yes.
So we'll just summarize, all right, for us as Christians to get through the world. And mind you, it isn't only the world that is today. It's just there's a lot more excuses that we can use to do things that we shouldn't be doing. Okay? Is to fight the good faith.
That's right.
Finish the course.
Yes, sir.
And keep the faith.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
3. Right? It's a magic number. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask you. We ask you to give us the strength, Lord, to keep your 3.
Yes.
All right. Thank you, Lord. We ask you to keep the 3. Give us strength and an endurance as well.
Yes.
That we don't do it today or tomorrow, but we make it a way of our lives, Lord.
Yes. Yes.
That we seek the truth through you.
Yes.
Not through man. We seek the truth through you, Lord. As you said, that you are always available for us and that you promised to take care of us, that you promised that you would never forsake us.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I